is Michael. My talk is about, so what about Ruby on Rails from a PHP guy. So as Shruti has introduced, I'm a software engineer. I work at a company called Neo Innovations. It's a software consultancy. We help clients solve tough problems. Yeah, so mostly web problems, validation, you know, stuff like that. So these are all my links. You can find me on Twitter, you can find me on GitHub, and you can go to my personal website, which is a bit outdated. So yeah, I prefer you go to my Twitter or my GitHub account. My slides are available online, so you can check them out at Speaker Deck. So there's a short link. You can take a quick shot of this if you want to, bit.ly/rrfromphp. So you have a bit of a mouthful there. Roar. Okay. All right, guys, come in, settle down. Hello. Hi.
Okay.
Hey, guys, you just come in, move down a little. There's plenty of empty seats here, actually. Or you can sit in the back. Go ahead.
Okay. Okay. take a quick snapshot of this. My slides are available online, so you can go check it out. Yeah. Of course, if I make any more changes later during after this, just now I was just still sitting there making some changes. I hope it all comes together properly. So about me, I'm a self-learned front-end, back-end iOS developer. So I started as a web designer, doing web design in plain HTML, front page, image composer. You know, this was in front page 98 back in the day, 1998, I think. No, wait, 97. Yeah, so then I went on to do some Flash development, websites in HTML, ColdFusion. ColdFusion was the first dynamic language I've learned, and then PHP. I've been using PHP for the last more than 10 years. I've been doing web design since 2001. I started the PHP user group in 2006. Currently, our Facebook group is about 2,000 members, I think of which two-thirds of them are probably bots. I also co-founded iOS DevScout. Mugun Kumar here taught me everything I knew about iOS development, which is cool. Mugun, me, and Suk, who is another speaker here at GeekCamp, we hope three of us co-founded iOS DevScout. So they're still active. They're on Facebook, you can find them. So I worked at Found, which is a startup back in 2010, and MiG33. Now they've rebranded to call MiG-Me. That was in 2012, and I joined in Neo this year in March, right? So this is kind of like brief history for anyone who doesn't know. So my topic is about Ruby on Rails and from PHP guy. So this is a little bit of a misunderstanding because it's not a fair comparison. So of course Ruby on Rails is a software framework, right? It's a collection of programming codes put together to form a framework. And whereas PHP is a programming language, or so it thinks it is. Right, so yeah, we'll go more into that later. So realistically we should be comparing Ruby versus PHP. Or if you want to compare framework to framework, it would be Rails versus Cake PHP, Symfony, Laravel, and a whole other bunch of pretenders to the throne. A bit more about Ruby. So Ruby is a dynamic open source programming language. It's focused on simplicity and productivity, and it's quite easy to use, easy to write. It's created by a Japanese guy. His short name is called Mats. He went public in 1995. It was open source rather in 1995. Current version is 2.1.3. It's Ruby on Rails was actually released in 2004, which is more than 9 years after Ruby came out. A bit more PHP. If you don't know about this already, it was created in 1994, around the same time, by a guy named Rasmus Ludoff. He released it as a collection of CGI codes. Basically, PHP stands for personal home pages. So he was creating his home page on the internet, and he found himself writing a lot of CGI codes, scripts to do dynamic stuff on his website. So back in the day when we had HTML, and then you want to do some dynamic stuff, you could do some programming in very low-level language like C or Perl. Was Perl around in 94? Anyone knew? I'm not sure. Yeah. So anyway, it was right, yeah. So in 97, he released it happily. It was called PHP/FI. So personal home pages / forms interpreter, which is kind of like his way of naming it. So in 97, two guys from Israel came along and said, look, I think this programming language, or rather this bunch of scripts, has some potential. So they came in and completely rewrote the parser. So basically, it was the first step of it becoming a programming language. So it was first released in 98, and they changed its name again from PHP, like PHP plus the home pages, to PHP hypertext preprocessor. Geeks like to make recursive definitions going on there. So it's like, why is PHP? PHP is PHP hypertext preprocessor. Like GNU is not Unix, kind of thing. Yeah, recursively. So yeah, maths. So the current version is 5.6.2. It's been around for quite a while. I started doing PHP when it was version 4, right? So it went through a lot of changes since then. Now it's 5.6. Most servers around the world are still sadly running 5.3. I think my previous company is still running 5.2. They're still running 5.2, sadly. So what about Ruby and PHP? So show of hands, PHP developers in the house, you know? Yeah, great. Ruby developers, also great. Python. All right, awesome. .NET.
Nobody owns up.
C#, okay, C#. Yeah, okay.
Nobody owns up.
Cool.
Visual Basic. Access Basic. That was one of my first language I learned, Access Basics.
Hey, you missed JavaScript.
Yeah, and, oh yeah, JavaScript. You're cool. So anyway, it's the similarities between Ruby and PHP. So both are interpreted languages. So you basically open a text editor, write some code, and it kind of interprets it. So you don't have to really compile it, unlike Go or Java or C# or everybody else in the room. So yeah, you just write it and the interpreter just understands what it does, right? They're dynamically typed and they're easy to understand, and they're also object oriented. Both of them are. They like to think that they are, PHP like to think it is object oriented too. It's not really that. So it has the trappings of object oriented programming language. But then you can still write spaghetti code, so yeah. Fun times. So anyway, the differences. So we have seen the similarities and the differences. So PHP is more or less web-centric. So you write, open a PHP code, you write some, you can mix in HTML with PHP, the interpreter won't die and puke all over it. So you render it properly as HTML, and when it sees a PHP tag, you'll interpret it as a PHP code, right? It's very, very web-centric. It's very easy to get and write and build a web page with PHP. Ruby is a bit more general purpose, so it's a little bit more involved getting it to render a web page. It looks simple and easy on Ruby on Rails, but there's actually a lot of other stuff happening before it actually renders the page. Right. So PHP is also not quite a language, it's more like a collection of functions, a collection of codes that seems to behave like a language. Of course, in the last few versions, they have added new capabilities to the PHP interpreter, which makes PHP more behave more like a language, a programming language. They have added things like traits. We have made some things more simpler to use, like creating arrays. And Ruby is a very expressive language. So if your primary language is English, chances are you understand Ruby, and chances are you understand. Yeah, it reads like English, unfortunately. So specifics, you can see that it's quite similar in a way. On the left, you see PHP code, which is in blue, and on the right you see Ruby code in red. So a string looks like this, quotation mark, double quotes, single quotes. Actually, I should add something here then. Interpolation. Forgot what interpolation is. So you add some string interpolations, it will look something like, in PHP it will be like, hello, world, or name, or something like that. Yeah, name, for example. Whereas in Ruby, string interpolation will look something like, hello, and we have a little hash here with this world, or name. One of the worst things a presenter could do is to code live. So don't ever do this. Okay, right, so yes, hello string interpolation, right. So Very similar. Number is a number. Float is a float. And variable, the way they declare variables are different. On the left, we have everything is in PHP is prepended with a dollar sign. With Ruby, it's a bit more straightforward. The only time when you put a dollar sign in front is when it's a global variable. It's available throughout the entire application. And then the way they access to static variables is this way. It's pretty straightforward as well. Constants are also declared the same way. Class constants are also used and declared the same way. Used in the same way, yes. Arrays. So arrays on the left is the PHP 5. Before PHP 5.4, the way of declaring arrays. In the PHP 5.4 onwards, they have changed it to the square brackets. So it's very similar to what you see on the right, which is Ruby, right? So the way that they declare the associative array, A, apple, B, bananas. So in Ruby, it's easier. There's no hash rocket there. Well, they still have a hash rocket, but the hash rocket is this guy here over here. Where's my cursor? So the hash rocket is equals and greater than. So that's hash rocket. So yeah. Ruby is a bit easy that way. One thing I like about Ruby is that you can, if you have a range of numbers like 1 to 5, you can just 1.5 and become creates an array with the range. Pretty handy. This is how you write some code in PHP. So you have an if else statement, you will look something like this on the left. Echo hello. In Ruby, it just puts. So it puts to the command line of the screen, right? So one thing a friend of mine, Valentine, told me is he finds the question mark in the method is a little bit funny. So, well, after a while, you get used to it. Yeah. Same as if you want something to be done or acted on an object, there's an exclamation mark, like dot upcase, for example. You put exclamation mark, it acts on the object, which is kind of nice. In PHP, it's not quite so. So, yeah. Okay. And also when you declare a class. So on the left you see there's a lot of curly braces and a big function word called function. You got to declare a class scope and everything. So that's kind of nice. So very Java-ish in the way. So on the left. So on the right is the Ruby. So you know it's just inheritance is very simple. Just a less than sign. So it declares an inheritance. Initializer is just initialize. Function declaration is just defined. Add water, add milk, those are instance variables which are made available throughout the entire thing. I think PHP kind of suffered from the fact that we use the full stop for something else. In PHP, we use full stop for concatenation, so string concatenation, joining two strings together. So which means we can't use full stops for things, for object-oriented stuff instance dot method, so we can't use that. So in PHP, you got to use a skinny rocket, skinny hash rocket. Yeah. So unfortunately, yeah. Don't even get me started on namespaces. Okay. / really. Okay. Anyway. And one thing I really like about Ruby is all the methods here are actually public. You need something to be private. This is how you would do it. So you need a method to be private. You just declare a keyword, private. Right, and then, so whatever method comes after that, def, secret, right?
Is it all the methods that come after that?
Yes, all methods that come after that are declared, are made secret. Right, so this is one thing I really like about it makes it easier to read. So anything below that, yeah, it's considered as private. So, which can be a pain in the ass sometimes when you put methods in the wrong place. You put a method that you want to be public, but you put it below the private, you're in trouble, right? So you've got to be really careful about putting stuff there. But then it's very easy. Just reread it, you can understand. You read it from top to bottom, private. Anything below this is all private. They also have a sense of protected methods as well. So inherited classes can only inherited classes can read it. Yeah, there's something else. Okay, something else, something I've not touched on is actually mixed ins. So Ruby has a concept of mixing in methods using a thing called modules. So you can create modules with a bunch of methods. You can at the top say include module name, and includes all the methods that you declare in a different module into this class. It can be like traits. It's really like traits. You write a bunch of traits and it gets injected into this. It's kind of cool. Other similarities. Console. I mean, it has interactive Ruby console, IRB. PHP recently, in the last few versions, they also released an interactive console. It's not as powerful. So basically just to type PHP space dash A, which brings you an interactive PHP shell. So you can do PHP-like functions in there. So you can, in the past, we want to test certain codes that does this thing actually interpret this way, or does it, you know, we're not sure about a method, you're not sure about how it works, you write a small PHP file and run it through the interpreter and see what happens, right? So you can actually do that now in the interactive shell, which is kind of cool. Ruby has this for a long time, it's called IRB. Debugging is fairly easy. You can just add, there's a library called pry, so you can add some debugging code into Ruby. In PHP, or as of PHP 5.6, I think it's made part of the core. So it's called PHP DBG, so which is a debugger. Previously, they also had PHP debugger, I think, yeah, X debugger, which also has the same thing. But it's a little bit heavy to set up, and not all frameworks support it out of the box. You need to, there's a fair amount of work you do to get it working, and it's at a application level. I mean, once you made it available, the whole web server has access to Xdebug instance, which is kind of a bit of a security issue if you're trying to do some live debugging. With Pry, it's built right into Rails. You can include it as a gem in Rails, and then you can basically just write binding Pry, and then you basically see the console stop at that point. You can start interacting with the code at the point where the debugger is, which is kind of handy, very easy to use. They also have Ruby also has called remote pry, so you can do you can remotely connect to the web server and do a step into the code if you need to, which is also quite cool. So testing, Ruby has test unit and RSpec and probably a few others, and PHP we have PHP unit. Of course, there are other things like Codeception. Has anyone used Codeception here in PHP? No. Ah, cool. Yeah, so that's a pretty cool framework. So they piece together a couple of frameworks like PHP Unit, and they wrote a DSL on top of it. So it's pretty easy to write feature tests. Feature tests, which basically test your web pages and stuff. So basically, it runs a headless browser, opens certain pages, or it even runs Selenium to test the features in your page. Kind of cool. So other similarities, both have a healthy open source ecosystem. So if you look at Ruby, they have this thing. Ruby has this packaging system called Gems. So if you go to Ruby Gems, you can find a whole bunch of this open source libraries that you can use and download. And chances are there are probably more than one gem available for a particular problem you're trying to solve. So there's a bunch of very smart people, they face the same problem as we mortal humans face. And they went out and tried to solve the problem for us. So they package it together as a library and share it in the open source community. But some chances are there are some older projects and some newer projects. So Ruby has a website called Ruby Toolbox, which you can find and get some statistics about each of the different projects. You can get a sense of which are more active ones, which are ones that are no longer being maintained. I can actually show you the site if I can get out of this. Oops. Sorry. You're not supposed to see that. So anyway, the PHP site, the Ruby site, the Rails site, Ruby Gems, there you go, Ruby Gems. So yeah, chances are you can find a lot of cool stuff here, like Pry, for example, you can find it here. It can tell you what it does, how you can include it in your project. So you just do gem install Pry, which is kind of cool. Ruby Toolbox. So if you're looking for anything in particular, like a say a debugger tool, right? You basically search by category and help you find the projects. See here, there are 30 projects which are categorized as debuggers, right? Columnize, debugger Ruby core, so many here. So with this, you can get a sense of which are more active projects and which are ones that have not been updated in a while. Like say, this is the first release in seven years ago, and it was the last release was 11 months ago, so still quite fairly active, for example. Yeah, and there's a quick link to the website as well. Like by bug, you can go check out the website. Sorry. Yeah, you can see. So one of the ways you can tell the health of the site is looking at the number of issues that they have. You know, how many open issues do they have? How many pull requests do they have? So this will be a good sense of how buggy this code is. Chances are you see a lot of issues, it's a bit buggy. But yeah, if they're all trivial, then it's okay. So, but you know. And you can tell by the number of releases they have, and when was the last release, you can tell how active it is, how actively maintained it is. Or if you find that you've discovered a bug, send a pull request. Please send a pull request. Don't complain and bitch about it on some forum, right? Yeah, so send a pull request, fork the project. Anyway, so in the PHP world, we have packages. Packages is kind of similar to Ruby Gems. So you basically use Composer as a package manager to basically download and install dependencies in your PHP project. So if you have things that you need to work on, like say you need an emailer library, or you need some login scripts or OAuth related libraries, you can find them all here. A good friend of mine created this one called OPOff. Hopefully it works. Yes, OPOff, yay. So you can search for this. This is a multi-provider authentication framework. So you can use this to create Facebook login, Twitter login, and all that stuff. Fairly easy. It's based off, it's got its inspiration from a similar project in the Ruby world called OmniOff. Which you can find it here. There you go, only off. Yeah, similar thing. Yeah. Right, so you can use, so the ecosystem around both are fairly healthy. Dependency management and packaging is also fairly simple. I talked to you about Ruby Gems. So you can use a thing called a bundler to basically put together, get a sense of what are the libraries that you need for your project. And bundler will try and resolve the conflicts and version dependencies and try and get you the right versions that you need that will work optimally for your project. In PHP, there's also a thing called Composer, which actually packages users. I hope I can show you bundler. Ta-da. I like the logo. It's a tape. It's a sticky tape, scotch tape. Something like that. It's kind of nice. Composer, the libraries here are fairly, so basically it's like a bunch of guys who came together and got really frustrated with all the different standards that were happening, and they decided to put together a thing called, in the PHP world, this is the PHP world, PHP FIG. So if you have not heard about this, you should really get and find out more about this. Come on, internets, let's go. And we just got it. This is embarrassing. Yeah. I'm on Yosemite GM3, so. I'm fairly hipster. Yes, I know. Unfortunately. Okay, this is going to be a long wait. La, la, la. Okay, PHP FIG. So the guys, the creators of a couple of PHP frameworks came together and decided they want to have a common way of working together. So the guys came together and created an interest group called the PHP Framework Interop Group. So they came together and they kind of established some working standards about how you should do inclusion of external libraries and stuff like that. So yeah, so okay, I just realized I got 5 minutes left. okay, I'm really overextending it. Okay, let's try to jump in. What I like about Ruby is the ecosystem is great. The problems are kind of solved by smart people. And you know, there are tools for developer happiness, like for debugging, for testing, da da da. And really, they're really big on testing. Ruby was really big on testing. And now we get into Ruby on Rails. 4 minutes left in my talk. Okay. So Rails is a front-end web development framework. So it's an opinion. It expresses an opinion on how you should build a website, right? They have opinions like you should consider configurations over convention over configuration, right? So programming conventions, naming conventions, where you should put the files, right? Over having you tweak this number, tweak that configuration to find out where your files are. So it's a model view controller framework. They're big on testing, unit testing, behavior testing, and feature testing, and so on and so forth. And it's really easy to run tasks on it. And new things like emailers, you can create HTML and text emails fairly quickly with this. One thing I really like about Rails that they have active record, you can do track schema changes very easily. Right, so in projects, how many times have you had projects where you end up having the production machine having a different schema from what you were using in your development machine, right? So you've gotten beaten by this quite a few times. So the guys who did Rails knew about this, and they created a way of helping you manage schemas. I think PHP frameworks, some of them have tried to do this, but none of them as elegant as the way that Active Record has done it in Rails. So it's pretty cool. So basically, you write a file and say, I have now a schema change. Create a new column, create a new table. Yes, it's very declarative. And basically, reading it, you can find out what changes were made between one commit to another commit. And you can roll back. You can even roll back the changes, which is fairly cool. And a lot of things are command line interface. In Rails, you just Rails dot, Rails new, you create a new project. And there's a lot of users, this thing called RIC, which is a tasking library. To do a lot of stuff like DB migration, resetting databases and stuff. And one thing I really like in Rails is that when you have a problem, there's a gem for that. Chances are problems is already solved, and usually it's a drop-in solution. Like say, I don't like the default templating engine used in Rails. You can easily drop in another templating engine like Slim, Ruby Slim, or Mustache, or whatever, by just adding it to your gem file. A gem file is like a file that controls what libraries you want to include in your project. So once you put that in, automatically it understands what you're looking for, and immediately it understands. Like say for example, you want to change to Slim, to a templating engine. So I just need to do the file name .html.slim, right? Or if you want to use ERB instead, you can just file.html.erb, which it uses the extension to kind of understand what you're trying to use, what you're writing in the code, which is fairly cool. In the PHP world, we like to say we invent the wheel because we have full control of and knowledge of how things work in our framework, in our project, right? So we want full control, and usually we have to code it ourselves. Because when we write something, when we use cake PHP, for example, the things that we need are usually sometimes not always there or not always as good as elsewhere. So we end up having to write it ourselves. So whereas in Rails, we invented the word auto magic. So it works like magic. It works and provides for common use. And basically it's relatively secure and production ready out of the box. And it lends itself to rapid development. So for example, we have login system. Well, you can use a gem per device. Or file uploads can use something called a carrier wave. The benefits, Rails, you can ramp up and build a web app very quickly. Commonly used stuff are always already built, and you're just putting things together. Deployment options are also fairly flexible and fairly easy to use. Like Heroku is free, just throw it out there. One dyno, easy to go, easy. Continuous integration friendly, easily testable. There are flexible DB options. So the migration scripts that you've written, it's database agnostic. It doesn't care whether you're using Oracle, MySQL, or SQLite. Right, it's the same declaration and understanding of what you need in your database schema, as long as it's a relational database. Okay, so and it's fairly easy to Google for a problem for solutions, and command line for the win. Right, so downside is pretty memory intensive, and but it's mostly solvable by throwing machines at a problem. So create more VMs. Right. Where to start? So try Ruby. Check out tryruby.org. Railscast. There's a Ruby meetup group in Singapore, so you should go and check them out. There's also a PHP meetup group, which I probably you've seen the page on my Facebook. There's also a Rails Girls Singapore. So basically, for ladies who are thinking of learning Rails, there's also a group in Singapore called the Rails Girls, which is basically a bunch of ladies coming together to learn programming in a group. And we are mentors. I myself, I'm one of the mentors in the group. So we basically teach through a guide. It's a guided process to teach you, walk you through the writing of codes. Guys are also welcome, as long as you bring a girl or something, you know, it's fine. You know, Luther here has been to a couple of our Rails Girls meetups, so it's kind of cool. The next one is coming up next Saturday. It's at Popworks. And one last thing, my company is hiring.
Shameless plug for
me. Obligatory. Yeah, I have obligation. Please. Right, okay, so that's all.
Wait, so PHP or Ruby?
PHP is still my first love, but Ruby is still growing on me. Yeah.
Very proper answer.
Okay.
Okay. Anybody have questions for me? Okay. I have one. What made you shift to? What made you considering shifting to Ruby?
It was a professional decision because I joined Pivotal Labs, or rather, Neo. Why did I say Pivotal Labs? So I joined Neo. So Neo uses Ruby and uses Rails. It was the thing I really wanted to get into because joining Neo was a decision I made very consciously because Neo as a company is very nurturing in learning new languages and learning new things. They're really nurturing in training you and mentoring somebody new who's new in the company in learning something in building stuff. Right, so which is a very conscious decision I made, and I really wanted to level up on my programming skills. And I've already done a lot in PHP, right? So I've more than 10 years of working experience, and even some iOS development. I really wanted to expand my horizons, and Ruby was kind of like an easy win for me in a way. So I really wanted to get into that. And once I got into it, I realized that it's the ecosystem. The ecosystem around the Ruby community really impressed me a great deal, in the sense that any problems you have, somebody has a gem for it. And by just looking at the code or just including a gem, it helps you understand how awesome this community is. As in, wow, in the past, I had to struggle so much to create a login system, a login page, a registration page, I got a handled email that goes out to the user and stuff like that. And the Ruby community solved it with just one gem. It's called device. It's a fairly big library, of course, but then it is the problem that's been solved. So I find that the fact that they've made an effort to solve this problem is, I guess, having a framework that you can gravitate around is good. Whereas in PHP world, we have Cake PHP shippers, we have Laravel guys, we have Symfony, you know, guys, and all that other stuff. And we have CMSs like WordPress and Drupal. They all have different ways of handling all these things. And I guess the fractured nature makes it a bit harder. I think it's finding similarity in the Python world. In the Python world, we have projects that you really like, you gravitate towards, and you really focus on making better, right? Which I also find quite impressive about the Python community. Something I find sadly lacking in the PHP community, but they are making strides and changes, like in the framework FIG, is an effort in making that happen.
So for a beginner, what would you suggest, Ruby or PHP? Or is it use case defined?
I would say... depends on what you're working on. If it's a simple web project, I think PHP should be fairly good enough. But if once you're working on something more serious and you really want something to be easily... The problem with PHP is that you've got to write everything yourself, right? You've got to write stuff from scratch, and that's going to be... It's a pain. That itself is a pain. Whereas with Ruby and with Rails, once you create a new project and you include a library or gem, chances are it's already at a level which is production ready, semi-production ready, and it takes care of some of the some of the security loopholes that could happen, like say cross-site scripting, CSRF. All these things are things that Ruby and Rails framework has all handled for you. Whereas you're doing it in PHP, different frameworks have different levels of capabilities. Cake PHP does have some CSRF protection, cross-site scripting protection, but I'm not sure about the third-party libraries that use, the components that are included with Cake PHP and all that stuff. So the standards and quality control could be a question, and chances are if you can't find something which is good enough in the PHP world, you got to write it yourself, which is kind of a pain. And in the Ruby world, chances are it's already somebody's written. So in when you write stuff in Ruby, it became less of a problem of how am I going to do this. It becomes less of how am I going to create this thing, right? But more like, when you write things in Ruby, it's more like, why should I do it? Why should I even do it? Because someone can do this already, but why am I doing this? Why should I put in the effort, put all these libraries together, and put together a website that does something, right? So it's a question of why am I doing this, rather than how am I doing this, right? So that's for me was the biggest change in paradigm, right? In switching from PHP to Ruby.
Okay, we have a question from the audience.
Yep.
In the beginning of the presentation, you mentioned that even though the latest version of PHP is 5.6, a lot of people are using 5.3. So is there a reason why it's so so many companies are reluctant to upgrade their PHP version, not for security reasons?
So the question is about why are companies so reluctant to upgrade to the latest version of PHP? Mainly because some code, you don't know where you'll break. You really don't know where you'll break when you move from. You know the changes, you know the diff in what new stuff will introduce in newer languages, or rather newer versions. But chances are you don't have enough test coverage to tell you definitively when I move from version 5.3 to 5.5 to 5.6, what will break. Unless you have already been writing a lot of tests.
So isn't it dangerous because there have been a lot of security bugs related to outdated software?
Question is about security loopholes in older versions. Yes, it is a security problem for all companies. So, which is a problem this is a problem that some companies decided not to face. They decide to just reinvent the wheel, write the whole thing in Go, or rewrite the whole thing in Java, or rewrite the whole thing in something else. So it could be a danger. Or rewrite the entire application in the newer version rather than moving or upgrading the Ruby or the PHP version on their server. In the Ruby world, there's somewhat a similar problem as well. Because once you use Rails, like say a certain version of Rails is only compatible with a certain version of Ruby. So you try to upgrade to the newer version. Like in my previous company, we had an application running Rails 4.0 beta, right? So it wasn't even public release. So we had a lot of issues about should we upgrade to Ruby 2 because it was still running Ruby 1.9 on the server. Was it 1.8? I can't remember. Daya, do you remember? Anyway, yeah, so it was a danger in moving the Ruby version up, because if you move the Ruby version up, it may break, Rails may break, and then if we move the Rails version to the next version, something else may break. Which I think is fairly easy to solve as well, because chances are if you're writing a Ruby application, you have a certain inclination to write tests. And having tests makes it easier for you to check for these dependency issues. In the Ruby world, they have version managers. You can use RVN or RVM to kind of manage your Ruby version, and you can upgrade to the next version you need to. Yeah, and it helps you experiment with version changes. Problem with PHP, when you upgrade a version, the entire server moves. The entire server moves from one version to the next version. There are ways you can differentiate and silo the different versions, but it's not a very well established convention of how it is yet.
Okay, are there any more questions?
Yes.
Just a quick one. So, like you said, a lot of these reels kind of feel like magic. You know, like just words, right? You don't really understand how everything works together. So for someone who wants to run up, who really wants to understand how what the application works, you know, what would you recommend? Should we just, you know, try and build things initially, or like work on reels and try to understand that?
I think, okay, the question is about learning a new, learning a programming language, whether for building web applications, right? Whether from ground up, I would say, web application from ground up. Let's do it this time around.
It's more like, how do you go about learning? I mean, you can't really know everything,
so
what
do you
think about
it?
Sorry,
just right.
For someone who wants to really understand how
this works. Sure. Right, I think when you write things in PHP, you're closer to the actual implementation of the code. So when you do something in PHP, chances are you read the source code, you should kind of know. Even if it doesn't work, you can circumvent it. But then the problem is you are looking at something and try and invent something which, or try to build something which may not be standard space. Whereas if you try something in Rails, chances are the implementation and the way that things are done are put together are also standard space. And it's not true that it's, you can also look at the gems. You can use a command line and to open up the gem file. And the entire basically all the codes that are in the magic. You can look under the hood and see what how the magic happens, which is also quite interesting.
Okay, so if that's all, okay.
Just seeing a question about the downside of memory usage. How serious is it? I mean, I'll come to PHP, but I know when you want to revamp it, and then you go for
memory problems. Okay, memory problems in memory problems. Actually, it's a problem where you can throw hardware at it and try and kind of solve the problem. Yes. PHP does take up less memory, but then it's also limited in what you can do. It's single threaded, can do a lot. There are limits to what you can do. Ruby is multi threaded and you can kind of do more stuff on it, I believe. It's a solvable problem. Whether to rewrite it, I don't know. Let's chat about it later. I'll give you some tips. Alright.
Okay. Thank you so much, Mike. Any more questions? We have time for just one more question if anybody has a question at all.
So, yeah. Okay. One last one. Have I used Laravel? The honest answer is I have tried. It's comparable to Ruby on Rails. These are all pretenders, or rather, they all get inspiration from Rails. Actually, even before there was Laravel, there was Cake PHP. Before Cake PHP, there was PHP on track. I think it's called PHP on tracks.
What?
There was something like that. Seriously, rot. I kid you not.
Rot.
Huh?
That would be rot.
I have no idea.
PHP.
Yeah, a lot of these guys try to do something similar to what Rails does, but the language itself, the PHP language itself, is somewhat crippling. There are some things that you really can't do effectively in the PHP, in just writing stuff in PHP. Like, say you want something, write something asynchronously. You'll do something asynchronous task. In PHP, you gotta probably write a queue-based system and try throw stuff into Revit and queue, and then have a bunch of workers do this stuff. In Ruby, it's a little bit easier. Apparently, they still use some queuing systems, but it's still easier, right? Just because of the fact it's multi-threaded and run stuff, can create long-running tasks in the background very easily. Whereas with PHP, it tends to garbage collect and throw stuff away, which is kind of, yes, any other questions?
Okay, I think we're out of time, actually.
All right, okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mike. Let's give Mike a round of applause.